Hello there. My name is Dr. Anton Jessup, curator of monster studies here at the university. Now, I'm currently on something of a forced sabbatical from teaching, which is fine because down here in the university basement, there's more than enough to occupy my attention. I've been thinking about mummies a lot recently, and really, what boy doesn't? More specifically, I'm intrigued by the way in which these long-dead, desiccated corpses rise from their ancient slumber and terrorize the living. Thousands of years ago, they were Egypt's honored dead, specially prepared for a cosmic journey, a voyage through the gates of death and onto a new life in the worlds beyond. But fate can be so cruel. Their well-stocked tombs long plundered, these ancient beings awoke from their millennial slumbers to the stuffy confines of museums and storehouses. Understandably enraged, they enacted their grisly revenge on any human in sight. Their gait may be slow and lumbering, but their crushing grip and embalming expertise makes for short work of their victims. Simply insert a long hooked tool up through the nasal cavity, break through the bone, and into the brain. Now, I don't blame them at all, do you? After all, this isn't the world they were promised. Their cosmic voyage was hijacked. What intrigues me is the strange biology of the reanimate mummy. We're left to assume that atmospheric moisture in their new environment gradually revives them from their slumber. And to understand how this works, we must turn once more to the wonders of the natural world. For the vast majority of their existence, mummies sleep in a state of anhydrobiosis, literally life without water, a dry state of suspended animation. So-called resurrection plants, such as Selaginella lepidolphia, enter a dry, dormant state between rains that lasts for years. Elsewhere in the plant kingdom, lotus seeds have germinated successfully after 1,000 years in the dust. A number of extremophile organisms also undergo anhydrobiosis, but the only multicellular animals known to bounce back from the dry reaches are rotifers, nematode worms, and tardigrades. Also known as water bears, tardigrades can undergo anhydrobiosis at any state of their development, while other animals, such as brine shrimp, can only survive as dried-out eggs, and then only for 15 years or so. Of course, it's one thing for an organism to shrivel away to a husk, quite another for it to live again. How does one bounce back without sustaining desiccation damage to cells and tissue? Some organisms produce the sugar trehalose or sucrose to protect cells, while others utilize highly hydrophilic LEA proteins. The mummy's resurrected rampage raises the big question. Is anhydrobiosis possible with human beings? Well, if the ancient Egyptians developed a means of protecting our complex biology from desiccation damage, they certainly didn't share the secret. And the mummies themselves are terrifyingly silent on the matter. Yet researchers from the University of Campinas in Brazil believe anhydrobiosis might offer unique strategies in the future for the preservation of vaccines, human tissue, and donor organs, to say nothing of suspended animation for long-distance interplanetary travel. Like the mummies of old, might future astronauts one day slide dry and lifeless into a sarcophagus, bound on a cosmic journey across time and space? I hope we get to find out. Now, you'll forgive me, I have to finish my research here. But I do hope that you'll tell me if there are other monsters you would like for me to dissect for you here. I'll be waiting to hear from you. Interesting.